jump back into that, and we'll do the last few verses, and I pray it would bless you. So you can turn to Proverbs chapter 3, and as you're turning there, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you, God, for your beauty and your grace. I thank you for your love that is so good and is so real and is so tangible. I thank you, Father, that you love all of us so much that you sent your Son. And we are here to glorify Jesus. And we're here to honor Jesus. We're here to make Jesus known. We love you. We love your Son. We just thank you, God, that we get to gather. We thank you, God, that we get to be together. And I pray, Father, for your anointing upon this message. I pray that you would sort things out in the Spirit. God, help it to penetrate every heart in this room. I thank you, God, for your grace, your tangible grace, your tangible favor, your tangible presence in this room, Lord. I pray that people would be set free from disease, from migraines, from panic attacks, from fear. I pray as we just begin to speak your truth and speak your word, I pray, God, that miracles would be released in this house today, Father. We give you the glory and praise in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Amen. So Proverbs chapter 3, we've been in this. We did verses 1 through 18 over the last 2 weeks. I think probably one of the most famous verses in this whole chapter would be 5 and 6. You know, it's trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your what? Your paths. I love that. I think it should be a go-to for all of us in our life when we don't know what to do, when we don't know where to turn, when we don't know what to pray. Go to this verse. I trust you with all my heart. And it literally means I'm not going to support myself in my own ways of thinking. I'm going to support myself with the Word of God. I'm going to support myself with your ways of thinking. And I'm going to lean into you. This is a good word. And I just repeat that again because I think it's probably one of the most popular verses in this entire chapter. But the chapter's loaded with so much truth and so much wisdom. And he talks to the son. He says, my son, do not forget my law. Then again, he says, my son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord. And lots of good verses. But today, we're going to jump into verse 19. Hallelujah. And as we jump into this, as we read these few verses, I just want to remind you, you know, we're living in, I don't even need to remind you, we all know we're living in crazy times. I want to remind you of something. in case you didn't know this, we're living in some wild times right now. Oh, I didn't know that. I'll tell you about after church. No, there's just crazy times going on right now. And the thing that we need to remember is that sometimes we turn to different news stations to get a solution. Or we turn to a social media post or somebody's social media page to get a solution. Or we turn to somebody's book to get a solution. But we don't need to turn to people for a solution. Why? Because political pundits, they think this one day, and then the very next day or the very next week, they may think a completely different thing. And so they can lead our hearts and our souls and our minds in this roller coaster of emotions. But I love that there's one thing that never changes. Only one thing. And that is the Word of God. And so in this trying and difficult time, and over the last 8 months, with everything happening, I just strongly encourage you to get closer to the Word of God. Because there is peace found in God's Word. And there's just a steadiness to God's voice. And that you can count on Him not changing His mind. That when He speaks something, it's going to stay the same. And you can count on His Word. He's a man of His Word. Amen. I just felt like that was important to say as we jump into Proverbs chapter 3. But anyway, verse 19, let's get into it. The Lord by wisdom founded the earth. Say, founded the earth. And by understanding, he established the heavens. By knowledge, the depths were broken up and clouds dropped down the dew. That's pretty cool. So God framed and he created the entire world by wisdom. He literally designed the entire universe and he established the heavens. He established everything that we know to be in this earth. He established it all by wisdom. He walked in wisdom. He is wisdom. And he spoke things out and he framed the universe. He framed the world with wisdom. We're made in the image of God. We can begin to frame the world that we live in by the words that we speak, whether negative or positive, whether not biblical or biblical. We can be literally by wisdom. If we lean into God and lean into wisdom, you can change the course of your life. You can begin to frame, build a new framework for your life, for your family, for your legacy. Amen. This is so good. And so God, the master designer, the master creator, by wisdom created the world. I just love this. My son, let them not depart from your eyes. Keep sound wisdom and discretion so they will be life to your soul and grace to your neck. Say life to your soul. That word, when you look it up, it's not just life, which life is powerful in itself, but it really means refreshing. And it refreshing to your heart. And so when we lean into God's wisdom and we hold on to discretion, as it says, he says, I'm going to bring refreshing to your heart. And there's going to be grace to your neck. Grace is a gift, amen. And what is it? What that means, this literally can be translated that it's a gift that is given to you, almost like a necklace that is worn around your neck. And so it's a gift that when you're walking in the grace of God, when you're walking in the favor of God, all will see what is hanging around your neck. All will see the beauty of God upon your life, that you lean into the principles of God. You lean into the promises of God. And you don't have to boast about it. It's just everybody can see it on your life. Amen. It's a gift for all to see. I'm going to read through the rest of these verses, and then I'm going to come back and hang out on a couple verses that I think are very important and what the Lord was really kind of speaking to me for today. But I just want to read the rest of them just to get through this because there's lots of good truth in it. Hallelujah. And your foot will not stumble. Then you will walk safely in your way and your foot will not stumble. Hallelujah. When you lie down, you will not be afraid. Yes, you will lie down. Your sleep will be sweet. Do not be afraid of sudden terror nor of trouble of the wicked when it comes, for the Lord will be your confidence and will keep your foot from being caught. Do not withhold good from those to whom it is due, when it is in the power of your hand to do so. Do not say to your neighbor, go and come back, and tomorrow I will give it when you have it with you. Do not devise evil against your neighbor, for he dwells by you for safety's sake. Do not strive with a man without cause if he has done you no harm. Do not envy the oppressor and choose none of his ways. For the perverse person is an abomination to the Lord, but his secret counsel is with the upright. Amen. The curse of the Lord is on the house of the wicked, but he blesses the home of the just. That's a promise. He blesses the home of the just. Surely he scorns the scornful, but he gives grace to the humble. The wise shall inherit glory, but shame shall be the legacy of fools. There's a lot in that, in those verses, but something for me, I just felt really highlighted, was found starting in verse 24. It says, when you lie down, you will not be afraid. Yes, you will lie down and your sleep will be sweet. Do not be afraid of sudden terror, nor of trouble from the wicked when it comes. For when the Lord will be your confidence, and he will keep your foot from being caught. Amen. There's this wonderful thing that really is standing out to me in this verse. It kind of reminds me almost of a Psalm 91. It's this thing of supernatural protection, and it's this thing of supernatural peace. And I believe that we're living in a time where the enemy is working overtime to destroy and to take away our peace. More than almost any time I've known in history, he is just working overtime to rip off peace from individuals' lives. And so many at night cannot find this verse to be true, because many people are lying down at night and they cannot sleep. They are incredibly anxious, having panic attacks, full of depression, full of anger, full of all these things. And we say, wow, if this is a promise, maybe it is just a promise for 2021. Maybe this will kick in the next following year, January 1st, the benefit package will kick in. No, like this was written from God, and it was the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so no matter what season we're walking through, no matter what season we're going through as a world, as an economy, individually, whatever struggles are going on, the Word of God is the same. And I know there's a lot of things that are happening in our society across the globe. You know, it's happening in Mongolia, and many of our brothers and sisters all over the world are, you know, they're just getting beat down economically and spiritually, and just feeling like giving up many times. But there's this virus, you know, and whatever you think of it, it's there, and it's just doing a lot on our economy. And it's ruining people's lives. It's ruining people's day jobs. It's destroying businesses. It's destroying state by state. It has been ruining people's lives. It's an agenda from the devil. So you got this, and the economy, so the virus is causing people, you know, and some people are really scared of it. And I'm not. But I'm not going to shame people that are. And if they are, I just want to pray for them, and I want them to get free. But people they're afraid of the virus and worried about the economy and civil unrest and natural disasters and all these things. And it's just like one thing after killer hornets, right? Murder hornets. You know, it's like, what is next? You know, and yes, and just all the political stuff right now. There's a lot going on more than any time in history. And so if you look at statistics, you know, anxiety, depression, panic is up, you know, going through the roof. You know, many can sit here and say, well, I'm fine. I feel like I'm the best I've ever been. Well, praise the Lord. That's awesome. But as a country, people are on antidepressants like never before. They're taking medication like never before. And so there's a problem right now in our country. And we need to begin to address this problem. And we need to begin to talk about how do we get our peace back. Because I believe that this still is true. This still is a promise. It's not just something that we might have. It's not just God's good idea. Today I give you my good idea. I hope it works. You know, no, this is a good and awesome promise. Every promise in the Word of God is yes and amen. Say amen. Amen. This is God's promise to us. And so I want to turn to a very familiar portion of Scripture, because I felt like God was just kind of speaking to me in my own life and giving me a couple nuggets of truth that I feel will help us in this journey to get our peace back. And if you have your peace, praise God. But I want to teach you how to get it, how to hold it, how to never lose it. And the Bible talks about it. So it lays that out beautifully in Proverbs chapter 3. You can have peace. You can go to sleep at night and you can sleep with sweet dreams. You know, we tell our kids, sweet dreams, honey. But, you know, the Lord wants you to have sweet dreams. The Lord wants you to have sweet sleep. He doesn't want you to put your head on your pillow and just be anxious about the next coming weeks and months and where is this going to come from and where is that going to come from. No, he wants you to have sweet sleep. But I believe the solution and the antidote is really found in the book of Philippians. And Paul lays this out beautifully. And I just want to remind us of this, a couple of verses in the book of Philippians. And I hope this will bless you and minister to you. So starting in verse 4, it says, rejoice in the Lord always. Say, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Verse 6, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Verse 8, finally, my brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and you received and you heard and you saw in me, these do. And the God of peace will be with you. So I want to talk about peace. The peace of God that passes all understanding. This powerful supernatural gift that is available for every believer. But yet many don't have it. And I believe many times in my life I've memorized Philippians 4, 6, and 7. I've memorized it. I know it. I know it, and I love it. It's been one of my favorite verses for a long time. I will pray it over people. I give it to people. But here's the thing that God was really showing me, that if all you have is verse 6 and 7, you're missing it. We're missing what Paul is really trying to tell us, because I can read chapter 4, verse 6, be anxious for nothing. Okay, I'm anxious. Okay, I'm not going to be anxious. 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 Self, don't be anxious. Self, don't be anxious. But that does not do anything. I cannot convince myself to not be anxious. I cannot convince myself to not panic. I cannot convince myself to do anything. And neither can you. See, it does not start with convincing ourselves. It doesn't even start with prayer. It starts with rejoice. Maybe you've seen this, maybe you know this a long time ago, but this just kind of came alive to me, that this whole portion of Scripture, it comes alive and is activated with praise. It's activated with rejoice in the Lord always. Rejoice in the Lord always. And you're like, well, yeah, okay, that's Paul. It's the Apostle Paul. Of course, you know, he's got to say something like that. He was writing to the believers in the most horrendous conditions, right? He was writing from a prison in Rome, not the Hilton. He wasn't writing like by a creek somewhere and like the birds were flying by and he's like, oh, what a beautiful moment. This reminds me of praise. You know, don't be anxious for anything, but be calm like this flowing brook, you know. That was not in the environment. And I love those moments. I love sitting by creeks and I love sitting by the ocean and getting revelation. And there's nothing wrong with that. But this is not the context for what Paul is saying. He is writing from a prison. He's just been beaten. He's chained up in the lowest parts of the prison. And he said, be anxious for nothing. And I love that he practices what he preaches. Because you look at chapter 16 of the book of Acts, I love that, where Paul and Silas are in prison. Do you remember this? And they have been beaten. They have been falsely accused. They have been beaten. They have been shackled and chained and now brought down to the lowest parts of the prison. And they're sitting in the prison. And if there was ever a time in Paul's life and in Silas's life where they could have been like, I'm just mad, you know, like, I'm going to just flesh out a little bit because this is so unjust right now. I'm chained. They are not letting me go to the bathroom. Like, I'm not getting any break time. You know, like, if there was ever a moment to flesh out, it would have been right here. And raise his voice and shout and scream at the guards and you don't know what you're doing or call down fire, whatever you want to do. Like, it would have been in this moment. But he didn't do that. He didn't shout. He didn't scream. He didn't cuss. He didn't try to, you know, beat a guard up. What did they do? Acts 16, they lifted their voice and they begin to praise. They lifted their voice in thanksgiving and praise and they begin to sing to God in the midst of their pain, in the midst of uncertainty, in the midst of questions, in the midst of brokenness, in the midst of what seemed like broken promises and broken dreams. They realize, God, you're still good. And no matter what this external looks like, I'm going to praise you. And they lifted up a sweet sacrifice to Jesus. That's why it's called the sacrifice of praise. It's going to cost you something. You don't always want to do it. Amen. I'm sure in that moment they did not feel like praising God. They're chained. They're sweaty. It's stinky. People are going to the bathroom right there next to them. But they lifted their voice and something shifted in the heavenly. Something shifted in that prison and broke the chains off their life. Amen. And so there's something powerful about praise. Say praise. And Paul is teaching, really, he's teaching us about faith. He's teaching us how to rise above our feelings. Because our feelings are very strong. And we get them, and it's okay to have feelings. You know, hello, God gave us the feelings. It's okay to have a feeling, but feelings cannot control our life. And feelings cannot dictate what path we take, and feelings cannot dictate how we communicate to people and how we communicate to God. Feelings should not be driving us. Faith drives us. And Paul is saying, I want you to be able to rise above your feeling right now. I want you to be able to rise above your circumstance. Rise above the political upheaval. Rise above COVID, guys. Rise above civil unrest. Rise above economy stuff. Rise above natural disasters. Rise above all of this and give him praise. Amen. Amen. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. They praised him. Rejoicing and praising God is actually the starting point to walking in a life of peace. Rejoicing and praising God, it is the ignition on your spiritual engine. Without rejoicing, because why? Because you don't feel like it. I don't feel like praising him. I'm mad. I'm offended. I'm angry. I'm depressed. Whatever you are, we just feel like, and we just sulk, and we hang out in our misery. But as soon as you choose, and it's a choice, as soon as you choose to worship, you now, by faith, step out of that thing and you come into the presence of God. And it's in the presence of God that anything is possible. And it begins to start that spiritual engine. It's like before you're sitting there and it's like, dun 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 dun. Oh, I'm out of gas, you know. But you begin to lift your voice and you begin to lift your praise, not because you feel it, but because you know he's good. God, I love you. God, I praise you. God, I worship you above my situation, above the doctor's report, above the finances, above anything going on. I worship you. I praise you. I adore you. And all of a sudden that engine clicks over and you begin to drive. Amen. It is the spiritual ignition. It is the exact change when you come to a toll booth. Have you ever been to a toll booth? I was in the Bay Area, and they have a lot of toll booths in the Bay Area. And I remember I was going to visit my family, and I'm so used to using my ATM card, had, and this was a few years back, I think I'll just use my ATM card. And I get to the toll booth, and he says, "I'm sorry, we don't take ATM cards. Exact change only." I'm like, "Oh, come on. Well, can you put the exact change in for me? Can you just push that button so I can get on through?" And they're like, "No, you can't use your ATM card. If you don't have exact change, then you got to turn it. I'm gonna open up this little side road over, and everybody's going to watch you. And you're going to be the guy that didn't have the exact change." I'm like, "Oh, all right. Well, fine. Okay." And so he clicks a button, and not the gate to go over the bridge, but a gate to go off the bridge and back that way. And so I get turned around, and I'm going in the opposite direction because I didn't have the exact change. And I have to go find a little gas station and you know, pray that they don't steal a bunch of my money and all these weird ATMs and random places and whatever. So I finally get $20 out, then I get the exact change. I go back over, and access granted. Amen. It's just a beautiful thing when you see that those gates lift up. But I want you to remember this, because sometimes visual, if you can just think of something visual, if it can land on your heart, and if you don't remember anything else, remember this. And so I didn't ask them, but maybe Patrick and Justin, can you just do me a little, can you come up here and just be a gate for me real quick? Just they're going to be a good gate. So you could just stand side by side, and you could put your hands out. Hold hands, maybe. There you go. Just hold hands. There's a gate. There's a gate right there. And I want to get through. You desperately want to get through. Your destiny's on the other side. Michael Dalton just came, and he prophesied over you. You have a purpose. You have a destiny. You're going places. And so, but all of a sudden, you feel one day you're in a funk. And so your prophecy, your destiny is just on the other side of this thing. But you're kind of in this funk, and you're like, "Man, I got a word. I got a prophecy, but I don't know how to get over there." And so you're just, what do? You begin to praise. And if you don't praise, you're like, I'm gonna make myself not be anxious. Don't be anxious, Mike. Don't be anxious, Mike. Don't be anxious. And then that's like me coming to the toll booth and saying, "Could I get through?" And they say, "Exact change."
Yeah. Give us your wallet.
So it's as almost if they have my peace right now. And so I need exact change. If I want the supernatural peace, which is just beyond them, I need to come with the exact change, which all it is worship. It's not, you don't have to go find something. It's just you find it within yourself. And you step out of your emotions. You step out of your feelings. You step out of your soul. And you say, "I'm going to praise him." And you begin to, "God, I love you. God, I worship you. I'm confused right now. This is a crazy season. I feel like crying sometimes. But God, you're so faithful." That's when you open up the gate. And the gate. Amen. Amen. And the gate opens, and you begin to go through. And you begin to walk in destiny. And it's at that moment that you begin to pray. See, it starts with rejoicing. See, rejoicing, worship, praise, it's not just a fun thing we do before the message. It actually will blast cobwebs off of your life. Worship will blast the junk that you've been believing, the lies that you've been believing, the tormenting spirit that's just been nagging you. You come into the presence of God, and that thing gets blasted off of your life. And for the first time, you're saying, "I believe." I believe, and now I can see my peace, but now you have to actually pray. So you blast that thing off you, so you're out of your feelings, you're into the presence of God, and then you begin to walk in verse 6 and 7. So it starts with rejoicing. It is the spiritual ignition. It is the exact change at the toll booth. I want you to remember that. Come to the toll booth with the exact change. Hallelujah. And then it says, "Be anxious for nothing, but with everything by prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." Hallelujah. "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart." Say, "Guard your heart." "And it will guard your mind in Christ Jesus." Amen. That's a good word. And so you come There's just a lot. And I feel like this is important because Proverbs 3 is a promise. But a lot of us are not accessing and walking in the promise because we don't know how to get out of our feelings. We don't know how to get out of our head. It always starts with praise. It always starts with worship. It always starts with a sacrifice of praise, whether you feel it or not, whether there's goosebumps or not, whether there's a strong anointing or not. Your breakthrough and your peace will start with your praise. Amen. And then you are in this realm. You're in it. You're in the presence of God. And you just believe again. God, and you begin to petition him. And you begin to ask of him. And things begin to shift. And the peace begins to guard your heart. And the peace begins to guard your mind. And you begin to walk in the peace of God. And now the peace of God is yours. It's not just something that you hear about. It's not something that you talk about. It's not just a nice Bible verse that you see on somebody's car. It is literally yours. But there's another part to this as well. You see, the enemy knows that you know how to get your peace. But he is trying really hard to work on the back end of this thing. See, he's like, okay, fine, worship, okay, pray, get your peace, that's fine, but I'm going to attack you right after you get your peace. I'm going to work so hard to steal your peace that you're going to forget that you ever even had peace. That's what he does. So he's going to work overtime on the back end of this. And so this is why Paul puts this in here. He says, you rejoice, and then he says, you pray, and then he says, meditate. And so this is the supernatural peace sandwich. God has given us the supernatural peace submarine sandwich right here. And the rejoicing, the praise, this is the bun. This is the nice bread of the sandwich. Prayer is the meat. You got to have some good meat in there. Without prayer, you're just eating bread, you know. So you need the prayer. You need the meat. And then meditation is the other side of that sandwich. And you put that together and you get God's sandwich for your life. That's lunch for you. But meditation, this is where you seal it in your heart. Finally, my brothers, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's anything of good report, if there's any virtue and if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things that you learned, received, and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the secret to walking in a life of peace. It starts with rejoicing. It starts with starting that spiritual engine. And then you begin to pray. But if you're not going to believe the lies of the enemy, you have to meditate. And you meditate on what is pure. You meditate on what is true. This is true. See, the enemy wants to tell us lies, and so how do you counter the lie? By believing the truth. But many times, you know, we try to put the word in us before we've broken through with worship, and we've broken through with prayer. And so I suggest, and from Paul's writings, I see that you worship, you pray, and you meditate. So I would do it in this exact order. And you meditate on God's word. You meditate on what is holy, on what is pure, on what is lovely. You meditate on God. You spend time with God. And the Bible says in verse 7, it says that the peace of God that passes understanding is going to guard your heart and guard your mind. But then it says, as you meditate, that the God of peace himself is going to be with you. So he's going to guard your heart. He's going to guard your mind. But I don't want just God's peace to guard me. I want God with me. How many want? I mean, that sounds like the better promise to me. I don't just want him to throw like an attaboy at me. You know, like, you got this. I'm, you know, the dad on the stands of a football game. Like, you got this. No, I want him to be with me. And you need God with you. We need him, the Prince of Peace, the God of Peace. He will be with you. Amen. And I feel like, we always worship. I love worshiping after the service. But I felt like it was incredibly important today to do something as an act of faith, if you can come up, we're gonna praise, and we're gonna sing a song to the Lord as an act of faith. And maybe you feel fine, maybe you feel free, maybe you feel so much hope right now, and praise the Lord. But maybe you don't. And maybe somebody's watching right now and you don't feel that. You can. Because it doesn't matter what we are feeling. It matters what God's promise is. And if the Lord said in Proverbs 3, when you lie down, you will not be afraid. You will lie down and your sleep will be sweet. Do not be afraid of sudden terror. There's a lot of sudden terror right now. Nor of trouble from the wicked when it comes. For the Lord will be your confidence and will keep your foot from being caught. Thank you, Jesus. Another scripture that was kind of highlighted to me is Psalm 94. David said, in the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comforts delight my soul. In the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comforts delight my soul. I love that David knew where to turn when his heart was feeling perplexed. I love that he knew where to turn when all hell was breaking loose against his life, when he was feeling anxious. He had a word that he was going to be king, but it seemed that everything was working in the opposite. His own king wanted him dead. His own army wanted him dead. People were chasing him around trying to kill him. His family was kidnapped at one point. His village was burned down. Everything wrong that could go wrong for a man was going wrong. And he constantly turned to the Lord. You got to believe there was some anxiety and some stress and a little bit of panic in his heart. In the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comforts delight my soul. So we have to begin to turn our face once again, no matter what we feel, no matter what the doctor has said, no matter what's going on in your heart or what's going on in your life and what you're battling in relationships, we have to once again turn our affection to Jesus by faith. If Paul could do it in the worst of the worst situations, chained in a prison, how about us? And if the Lord would blow in that prison and shake that prison door and bring freedom, what will he do for you? And what will he do for me? But it starts with worship. It starts with rejoice. And so we're going to just praise for a moment. We're going to worship for a moment. And I just want you to praise as long as you need to get that thing off of your shoulders, off of your mind. Whether it's stress because of a decision, financial stress, emotional stress, whatever is going on, I just want you to praise until that thing lifts. And as soon as it lifts, I want you to begin to pray. You can pray under your breath. You can pray out loud, but you need to pray. Even prophetically, there's a few people in this room that you can stand in place of somebody that's really going through it right now. And so I want you to stand with me. Just close your eyes, just connect with the Father. Put your eyes on him. Lord, we thank you for your presence in this house. We thank you for freedom in this house. Lord, Let peace come upon your people today. Let peace come upon your people today. Lord, we want to be led by your peace, but we want to know the Prince of Peace. And we want to know today that you're walking with us, that you're walking next to us, that you're with us every step of the way. I pray, let the Prince of Peace rush into this room right now. Rush into every heart, into every situation, into every circumstance. The Prince of Peace walking into your life. Walking into your life. I see even a situation, seems like there's a fire. Your house is just raging on fire. And God comes in like this firefighter, kicking down the door and bringing you out, rescuing you from a dead situation. And so I just want you to experience the Prince of Peace today as you worship, as you pray, as you meditate. So we're just going to sing this, and I want you to activate it personally.
Touching every heart, I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. You are here, mending every heart. Oh, I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Forevermore, Lord. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You All of my days.
Father, I thank you that you've given us the tools for victory. You've equipped us. You've given us everything that we need to walk in freedom, in hope, in peace. That the abundance of peace is just a breath away. The abundance of peace that you so long to rush over your life is just one praise away. It's just one amen away. It's just one hallelujah away. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard you, protect you, and bless you. I could take you to moments where I was in the backside of Mongolia dealing with depression and anxiety and some fear that was trying to attack me. And I began to worship with my Mongolian brothers, and something shifted. I remember when I was in India, and we were going to do a meeting in India, and I felt ill-equipped. I felt like I don't have what it takes to be in this situation right now. And I just began to turn my affection to Jesus. I began to worship him, and all of a sudden, the peace of God began to fill my heart. And so praise will bring the breakthrough. When we are dealing with situations with our daughter, we didn't know what to do, feeling discouraged, feeling beat down, feeling defeated. I began to walk around outside. I had no prayer room. And so the city streets began to be my prayer room, and I began to walk down the city streets of Los Angeles, Sunset Boulevard, and I just began to pray. I just begin to worship. I just begin to put my earphones in, my earplugs, and I begin to praise God. And something began to shift internally. And Heather began to do the exact same thing, and she began to praise. Something shifted. It's got to shift in us before it shifts out there. And so my encouragement to you today is keep praising. Jehoshaphat, King Jehoshaphat, they were goners. They said, there's no way we're going to win this war. The Lord instructed him, put the worshipers at the front. And so worship is not just an idea. Worship is warfare. Worship breaks you into the presence of God so that you can then begin to petition and ask those things that are deep within your heart. And so God, we just thank you for today. We thank you for the revelation and the promise of peace, and I pray it would settle and rest on every person in this room. Whatever the enemy does to try and steal it, I pray, God, we would remember these three things: to praise, to pray, and to meditate. And so we give you the glory, we give you the honor, we give you all the praise in the mighty and precious name of Jesus. And everybody that agreed said, amen. God bless you. If you need prayer for anything, come on up.